Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I think we're going to get started. Dear colleagues and friends of the Käthe Hamburger Center, Law as Culture, a very warm welcome indeed. I hope it is not too warm. I cannot promise you that the debates will not make you even warmer. Hot debates, I'm hoping for. But what I can promise is cool drinks afterwards outside. So we're looking forward to both. Our speaker tonight is Professor Helga Lell, who will give a talk on the legal concept of person in Argentina's legal system. With this topic, we will continue the debate we started at the lovely event last Wednesday in the Kunstmuseum. I see some new faces, but quite a number of you were present last week and enjoyed the presentations surrounding the exhibition on the mask. Tonight, we will delve a little deeper into the legal notion of the person, the persona, as exemplified by the Argentinian law and the recent changes there. The concept of person indeed constitutes a fascinating and a very challenging topic for our transdisciplinary debates. This concept of person, it is known to all legal systems. They all confer rights and duties on persons. However, often they do not really define who or what a person is. It is simply assumed that this concept is omnipresent, known in all societies, and consequently there is no need for a definition. Frequently, at least, we encounter the differentiation between natural person and legal person that you already mentioned last week. With a natural person, it seems pretty obvious what is meant. A natural person being an individual, a human being. Here, the law does not seem necessary to create or define the person. Instead, as a human being or a natural person, one has fundamental human rights, such as life, liberty, for example, freedom of expression. However, with a natural person, the difficulties arise when we consider the beginning and the end. When does a person come into existence? This question gains relevance with the regulation of abortion, birth control, reproductive medicine. But also, when looking towards the end of human life, we have to consider whether the law creates and consequently extinguishes a person. Here, culture and religion matter, as views differ largely which bodily functions should be decisive, breath, heart, or brain, as the big controversy, for example, surrounding the Israeli Brain Respiratory Death Act has demonstrated. With a view to the legal person, it is much more obvious that this is in fact a creation of law. Often legal persons, such as corporations, were created as persons with their own rights and duties in order precisely to shield the natural person constituting them by limiting the liability to the capital of the legal person. Interestingly, there is a well-known legal principle of piercing the corporate veil. It creates exceptions to the independence of a legal person, that is, ways of holding the members, the natural persons, liable despite the existence of the legal person, the corporation. The veil or mask, as one could say, provided by law, may thus be pierced or lifted in special circumstances, as this metaphor aptly describes. Just with these few examples, it is evident that the legal concept of a person is not an easy one. And before Helga Lell will enlighten us on its complexities, let me introduce her. Helga Maria Lell is professor of legal philosophy and director of the Center for Research in Legal Sciences at the Economic and Legal Sciences Faculty of the National University of La Pampa, Argentina. She studied law at the National University before finishing her doctorate at the Austral University. She also earned a diploma in social projects and methodology of social sciences, as well as a master's in social and cultural sciences and philosophy. Currently, Dr. Helga Lell is not only professor at the National University of La Pampa, but also researcher at the National Council for Research, Science and Technology. She's a member of various interdisciplinary research teams and has published widely in her fields of research. Her academic work was honored with several prizes and scholarships. And since April 2019, this year, we are glad to have you here with us at the center. I'm very much looking forward to your presentation. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much for your kind presentation. Of course, I want to thank the center. One person is honored to be here, it's me. I'm very happy about this environment, and because I'm also, I can also talk with people that have different point of views and come from other disciplines that can, of course, enlighten me in other matters that I'm not so used to. So it's a privilege to me to be here. Many of you could attend to the talk last week, so I'll try not to repeat the same topics, but at least I would like to make a short review of some important points about what implies to be a person in law. So why law as a discipline, as a science, and also as a practice, has this idea of a person? Where does it come from? Well, mainly it comes from a metaphor that relates the legal concept of person as an entity that has rights and duties to the ancient idea of masks. Masks that were used in ancient Roman theaters, also in Greek theaters, and in other cultures, such as the Etruscan culture, for example, where there was this word "persu," that might be the mother word of prosopon, the Greek one, and persona in the Latin word. There were further developments, especially about Christianity, when there was a translation in which there was a debate about the nature of Christ, if he was divine or human. And on the Nicaea Council, there was said that he was both, but he was one hypostasis, and the word hypostasis, that was a sort of substance, was later translated as person. So it was not only playing roles as a person, but also as being worth of certain treatment, as a certain substance that was related to the word person. And that came into law, and both ideas are quite problematic, but because they are not always well related or not always coherent. But this word that is present in almost every legal system as the word, but as Professor Dietloff said, every legal system provides laws and rights and duties. Why should we analyze it? Why shouldn't we focus on the roles instead? Why shouldn't we start just analyzing rights and duties independently from the word person? Well, this question, at least in Argentina's legal system, I think that can be answered, for example, thinking about some social, political, and economic consequences that interpreting this concept has. For example, many years ago, in 2001, in Argentina, there was a big economic crisis. One morning, everyone woke up, they had their savings in the bank, and there was a new rule. You couldn't get your savings out of the bank. That was named Corralito. So you wanted to buy something. If you didn't have the money in your wallet, you couldn't. Simply, you couldn't. Your money was in the bank. You couldn't take the money out of the bank. Your property was still there, but you couldn't have access to it. Is it okay that the state regulates your property that way? Is it okay? Is it just Is it right? Well, we can say yes, it is okay, or no, it's not okay. But both answers can be provided according to one notion of the legal concept of person. So it doesn't matter to define who is a person and to what extent law can define who a person is. Well, it is very important because according to what we think or how we answer this question, we will be analyzing how the state and how the law can distribute rights and duties. But after saying this, I won't be talking too much about these economic consequences today, but I think that it will be better if I share with you some important facts of Argentinian legal history that provide us a starting point to think about what is to be a person or who can be persons in Argentina's legal system. So, perhaps for those who are not history lovers, this might be a little bit boring, but it's necessary. Well, the first stage of the concept or the legal concept of person in Argentina's history should be traced when Argentina began as a state. When did Argentina become an independent state? Well, we can trace that to 1810. That year there was a big problem in Spain. Until then, Argentina was part of the viceroyalty of the La Plata River, and so independent, it was part of Spain. In Spain at that year, the king had to quit his throne, and he was kept captive by Napoleon. And so when the people of the La Plata United Provinces heard about that, decided to create a new government. And that's when the story began, because they made a revolution, but they didn't have too much support from other states in order to proclaim that they were independent. So they were still part of Spain, but not so much because of other reasons that I can't say that. But during this first stage that has all these years, we can see that there are a lot of documents about the governments that provide or try to regulate the rights and duties that citizens had. But when they try to say who are the citizens, who are the nationals, they use a lot of words. Of course they use a lot of words. Citizen, national, individuals, neighbors, persons, human beings. So all these words are not equal. They do not mean the same. But at those times, it was not so clear who was a neighbor, who was a citizen, who was a national, because there was still not an identity of what was to be part of the United Provinces of the La Plata River. But still, if you check all the documents where the idea of person shows up, person is clearly related to the idea of the human being. Still, there was an idea of this daily language, but not a technical idea of what it meant to be a person for law. In a few minutes, I will be coming back to these documents, especially to the National Constitution of 1853. That's the National Constitution that is still ruling. The second stage of the legal concept of person begins in 1869. What happened that year? Well, that year was the year in which the Civil Code was passed in the Congress. And in this civil code, there was a definition of person for law, and just for law. Daily language could use the word person, but for law, to be a person meant person is an entity with aptitude to acquire rights and duties. The person, or the individual, who wrote this was Bellis Sarfield. He was a legal scholar, and he studied quite a lot about Roman law. He wrote a note to this article, and he said that, first of all, he did not like the word or the concept of natural person, because the idea of natural person reminds the daily language. And to law, it doesn't matter if it's a human being or not. The only thing that matters are rights and duties. And he also said that he would follow some ideas of another legal scholar that was from Brazil, that was Freitas. Freitas wrote a project of civil code for Brazil, and he also explained a little bit some of his ideas. He wrote a pretty similar definition of person. He said that a person is an entity that can acquire rights, not the duties, but he thought that duties was or were part of rights. He explains many things about this, but mainly he says clearly that human persons, he says human persons, can be part of law in two ways. Acting by themselves, in this case, they are these visible persons, or they can be acting in representation of another entity that is related to them. And that was the definition of ideal persons. Bellis Sarfield, the Argentinian one, took these ideas for Argentina, and he said that, of course, visible persons exist. He doesn't provide a definition. We can, of course, know that the visible person is the one we can see. He doesn't relate it to the human person, but if we read Freitas' project, we can think about it. And when it comes to ideal persons, he says that ideal persons are those that are not visible. So, very short definitions. Still, during all the time that we had this code, until 2014, the idea of visible persons have been interpreted in many, many ways. We'll talk about it in a few minutes. But right now, having explained this article or this section, we can wonder what was the image that Bellis Sarfield had in his mind when he wrote this. I mean, which was the role model that he was thinking of a person when he wrote this section. If we check on the context, the historical context, we can see that it was an important moment for the country. As I said before, we had a constitution in 1853, and this constitution was, of course, a product of many ideas. These ideas belong to many politicians that wrote essays. One of them was Sarmiento. Sarmiento was also the president when the civil code was passed. So we can see that his ideas were pretty important at that moment. Sarmiento wrote a book that's called Facundo Quiroga, Civilización y Barbarie, it's Civilization and Barbarians, in some way, and he tries to describe how the society in the country was. This is Argentina nowadays, but at those time, in 1853, it was not like this. It was just a little piece of this. It was, okay, I'm going to have some problems with this button. It was about this. So just a very small part of what we know today as the country. And you may wonder, what about the rest? Well, Part of it are now different countries, but for example, this part was territory that was occupied by indigenous people. And also the same for this southern part. In this part, Sarmiento thought that there were very big lands and not too many people to live there. The population back there was less than 2 million people. It was a very big territory. And most people were living around here and here. So during all these other lands, there were a lot of leaders that had a lot of power. But actually, Sarmiento believed that they were a sort of beast because they only had strength and people who obeyed them. But these people did not study, did not have an education. So he describes the country as a lot of people who can only fight, were very lazy, could only drink in bars and some stuff like that. There was another writer that was very important, that was Alberdi. He wrote a project of the Constitution. This project was later almost the same as the Constitution that we have nowadays. So his idea really mattered. Both of them, Sarmiento and Alberdi, said that it was to govern the country was to populate. It means that all these empty spaces should be filled with people, but not every people, because all these gauchos that were there were lazy, did not have an education, so we needed some other kind of people. And so a new policy began that was about bringing immigrants to Argentina. In both texts, in Facundo and the project of Alberdi, both of them say that we should foment, or the government should foment, immigration from European people. Not every European, especially Northern Europeans, such as British, especially, and other countries. And so, during the last presidencies, between 1853 and until the 20th century, there were a lot of policies that make or invited openly immigrants to Argentina. In fact, in the Constitution, we have an article that says the government must foment immigration that comes from Europe. So that's the role model of the Argentinian population. On the times that Belisarfil wrote the Civil Code in 1869, the first immigration policies began. So there were a lot of European people coming, but of course, to populate these empty spaces was not enough, because it was not only about populating these empty spaces. Another government saw that there was a very important economical opportunity. Which was it? Well, all these lands in the south have a great potential to raise corn, for example. And Europe was requiring that corn, so it could be sold. But there was a big problem, because there was not enough population. Okay, we have a policy to bring immigrants, but to locate them on this land, there was a big problem, because this land was not empty. As I said before, there were Indians over there. And so, if you want the lands, you need to do something about it. And there began a sort of a war. It was a government military campaign that was called the Desert Campaign. It was basically to kill all the Indians and win these territories to provide them to the immigrants. With this idea in mind, there was a new image of the Argentinians that perhaps some of you have heard about it. That is that the Argentinians descend from the ships. Well, this metaphor means that most of Argentinians come from the immigration that came from Europe. If you check the census, the numbers, you can see that there were more of almost 8 million people that came to Argentina at those times, which is a lot, really a lot. So the idea of this metaphor was all these ships that were coming with a lot of people are those who are building our nation. And with that idea in mind, Vélez Sarsfield wrote this article. But why am I telling you all these things? Why does this matter? Well, there is a very important thing that when Vélez Sarsfield wrote that, he was thinking that people that could acquire rights and duties were going to do that by making contracts. And the people who make contracts are economical subjects. And these economical subjects are rational. You know what they are doing, and of course they have autonomy and they are equals one to each other. So there were basically individuals that could create contracts. This definition, of course, had a lot of problems during the century in which it was ruling, because the civil code was first applied to other kind of contracts, not only civil contracts and commercial contracts. For example, to labor law. So people that were hired to work in some place were hired under civil contracts. And sometimes they did not have the same negotiation conditions with their employees. So that was a problem. So first, according to this, when problems came up, new rules had to be created. And especially, there was one politician that saw those problems, was Perón, and started creating different rules for workers. And that was the time where new statuses were created. And of course, it was a political power for him, of course. But even nowadays, to provide another example, in which this idea with the role model of white, European, rational, educated, autonomous, and equal men had some problems, we can see that in the National Constitution, that was this one of 1853, had one reform in 1994. There is a section that states the consumers and public services users protection. That is one of the few roles that you can see in the Constitution. And it's a very large section with a lot of details about how to treat users of public services and consumers. Why is it there? Well, it is there because on the 90s there were a lot of problems in Argentina, another economical crisis, and the government decided to sell the companies that were part of the state. And when they sold those companies, they did not only sell the companies that provided public services, but with the companies, the government sold a monopoly that belonged to the state, to private hands, but also sold some privileges that the state has. For example, if a service is not very well provided, you can complain, but you have to pay first. So you perhaps did not receive what you are paying, but you have to pay in order to complain. There are a lot of other ideas that were part of administrative law, but they belong not to the state, but to private companies. So the individual was not this one that was equal to the other part. It was just an individual that was captive from a company to which he had not even conceived a contract. And so we can see that this idea that Vélez Sarsfield had in mind had to change another time. A special role was conceived. Well, What happened after this? Well, the civil court was ruling until 2014. In 2014, a new civil code was passed, and it came into force 1 year later in 2015. This new civil and commercial code has a different kind of regulation about persons. First of all, it does not have this classification between visible and ideal persons. Now there are two kinds of persons: human persons and legal persons. Human persons are not defined. There are some characteristics attached to it. Those are that it is the human person is inviolable and must be treated with dignity. It also says that it has autonomy, but I think that that's more of an interpretation of mine, because there is another section that says something like this about the possibility of conceiving a life plan and how it should develop. This idea of human persons began or came into the civil code, especially because, first of all, nobody was using the idea of visible persons anymore. There were a lot of problems with the idea of visible persons, but especially because there is a very long tradition of human rights in Argentinian history. Two main reasons for that are, first of all, the last dictatorship that took place in the 70s. It was a very hard time in which the military government kidnapped and killed almost 30,000 of people. And so there is a big background not to letting the state define always what a person is, because there should be some other reason to be a backup against the state. That was one reason. The other one is that after the last dictatorship, and especially during the 80s and the 90s, a lot of treatises of human rights were passed in Argentina, and in fact, many of them have a constitutional hierarchy. That means that they have a lot of rights that are not named in our constitution, but if another treatise has it, it has it is as if it were in our constitution. So it, the idea of human person became quite important in the Argentinian legal system after this code was passed. There is another kind of persons that are legal persons that are present in the civil code, civil and commercial code. For them, the code has a definition. They are those who can acquire rights and duties. But so far we have two kinds of persons. The problem is that a lot of people say we have two kinds of persons, but the civil code does not say that we don't have other kinds of persons. So it's open. And that's where the main problem begins. There are a lot of special cases. Some of them have to do with interpreting this civil and commercial code. Others have a more historical background, but are still challenging our definition. Well, the special cases, we can begin with perhaps the most simple of all, humans that are persons. Well, nowadays, we know that, of course, humans are persons. Basically, because the civil code has that definition, we can trace that even in a lot of human rights treatises, and because, of course, the development of humanity tries to define persons as humans as a main topic. But that was not always the case. There are some cases in which, in the history, we can see that humans were not considered persons. First of all, slaves. well, in Argentina there were slaves too, of course. There were Afro-American slaves, but also a different kind of slavery that were Indians. Because, of course, when the Spanish came, they found a lot of Indians, and they used these Indians as an economic strength to, for example, take all the metals out from the mountains and to work in the land. So, going back to the map, I told you that in the middle of the 19th century there were two places with indigenous people remaining, over here and over here. All this place had, of course, indigenous people that were the first people that were servants and a sort of slaves. Over here in the north of the country was the best or the most important place with silver. You know that Argentina means silver. The Rio de la Plata is silver. So what could be the most important place in the entire country? Over there, that's where the silver was. So all this way was important because here was the port to go to Spain. So this was the way in which all the Indians were here working to bring out the silver. And also here because they were providing food in the land. So that was perhaps the most important moment of slavery in Argentina. After the independence, or after the revolution and before the independence in 1813, there was a first attempt to abolish slavery. The assembly that was with the project could not abolish slavery because Brazil complained. The main idea was that every slave that would step into Argentina would set free, and Brazil was concerned that a lot of slaves would run to Argentina to be free. So the only thing that this assembly could do was to state the freedom of wombs. So every baby that would born of a slave mother would be born free. So after a few generations, it was supposed that slavery was going to be abolished, but finally the Constitution of 1853 finally abolished slavery completely. Among the special cases, there are other ones that are more controversial. Professor Dietloff already mentioned that perhaps one of the most controversial cases are those on abortion. So when does life begin? When does a human being begin? And that is quite important right now in Argentina. Last year there was a project, a legal project for a law, that was about legalizing abortion. Nowadays abortion is not legal, it's considered a crime. However, women would not go to jail, but doctors do. There are only two cases in which abortion is legal, in case of the mother's health is in danger, and the other one is in case of a rape. Otherwise, it's considered illegal, so abortion cannot be performed. Last year, there was a project. This project tried to not only legalize abortion, but there was some special points. The first one of them is that abortion could be performed until the week 14 with the woman not saying any reason for it, but after the week 14 until the end of the pregnancy, it could only be performed if there was a social, psychological or other kind of health problem for the mother. The most, perhaps the most discussed problem about this was that this project concerned or tried to establish that abortion was not only not more a crime, but it should be provided by the state or health insurances. So the main idea was that it could be free for everyone. This discussion had a lot of issues, was quite a good debate. It lasted for more than 6 months. Every deputy or senator could bring experts to the debate. and all the debates were on TV, so it was quite a good thing for the entire population. Well, finally, the law was not passed. There were other problems, like, for example, the freedom of conscience. People that, for example, have problems with their religion, for example, Catholics, had a very big problem because they could actually request not performing an abortion, but this project states that institutions could not claim for freedom of conscience. And the best hospital nowadays are some of them are Catholics, and so it was going to be a problem because they should guarantee abortion even if they did not agree. So that was perhaps one of the biggest problems. However, on this debate, there were a lot of interesting ideas, but one of the most discussed points were, when does human life begin? Well, one of the international treatises that has constitutional hierarchy says that life or human life begins with conception. And this is not exactly clear because after some consultants to the Inter-American Court, that's the institution that it's interpreting the Inter-American treatment, the Inter-American Court said that conception begins only when the embryo is implanted in the woman's womb. So before that, there is no human person, and Argentina has agreed pretty much with this idea. There are a lot of other problems because when the Civil and Commercial Code was written, they used the idea of conception, but before the former code said conception in the mother's womb, and now the idea of mother wombs was not there. So a lot of questions about what is the status of an embryo? It's a special thing, it's a human being, can we make research with an embryo? Can we throw away an embryo? What are we going to do with embryos? Well, nowadays, there is the Civil and Commercial Code says that a special law should regulate the status of an embryo. Until nowadays, we don't have such a law. In April, there was law project presented. We'll see what comes about that. But so far, it regulates especially the possibility of making research with embryos after 10 years of it being in a lab. Well, other cases of persons. The other day I mentioned already the idea of corpses. There was a big case in Argentina 100 years ago, so it's now a very old story, but once upon a time, a woman received a letter that said that, lady, we have kidnapped your mother. Well, it was pretty bad because the mother was already dead, so she didn't understand very well what it was about. But then she continued reading, and the letter said, well, your honor, she was part of a very, very important family in historically, in the province of Buenos Aires, if you don't pay the rescue, your honor will be very bad because you are cheap and you don't want to pay for having your mother back. Well, the main problem is that she, of course, called the police, but the police came and said, okay, she's not kidnapped because your mother is dead, and kidnapping involves a person. But nobody was actually sure to call the corpse not a person, just an object. So, well, finally, well, it was not a crime. The guys got caught. The mother was found in the cemetery in another tomb. But finally, the criminal code changed after that. And there is a special rule that says that kidnapping a corpse is a crime, but it's not a crime against persons. It's a crime against property. So corpses are an object, but it's a special kind of object. So until now, there is no doubt. Another case that I think it's very important because it's recent is the one of Sandra. Sandra is a monkey. There is a picture of Sandra that's actually Sandra. You can see her breathing. I don't know what she's doing. But Sandra was a monkey that was in the zoo of Buenos Aires, and the people that was taking care of her thought that she was a little bit sad. So an NGO studied her case and detected that she has she had some behavioral changes, and made a claim in a court saying that she deserved an habeas corpus to be moved from the zoo where she was captive to a sanctuary in Brazil. The main argument was that she was sad and that she could realize that she was being kept captive and that she had the feeling of freedom and she had no freedom. And so the court said, yes, Sandra is a monkey, but is a non-human person. So that's another kind of person that nowadays it's in Argentina's legal system. The main argument about that was that monkeys have cognitive capacities similar to human beings. But that happened on 14 December, and a few days after that, after this judgment came out, there was a big problem on a fabric. There was a company that was selling chicken, frozen chicken, and it went bankrupt. And the problem was that the chicken were there, and the workers went on strike and closed the doors and didn't let anyone to come in, and the chickens were starving over there. And so the NGO went and said, chickens are non-human persons. Well, courts had a very big problem because the main argument for the monkey was cognitive capacities. Chickens, well, not so sure. Luckily, the workers opened the door before the court had to decide, but the question remains, because any time from now there will be another habeas corpus of that kind. Well, another kind of problems or challenge to the legal concept of person is the one of rivers. In 2015, perhaps in the next talk we will talk about this, in Colombia, in also South America, a river was declared a person as or with a non-anthropocentrical criteria but an ecocentrical criteria. After that, in Argentina there was a claim for a river. The river is crossing over here, you can see it in the map, but it comes from Mendoza and crosses La Pampa. And there is a big cut over here because Mendoza produces wines and uses the water of the river to for the plants of the wine. And when the river comes to La Pampa, that's my province, it gets very dry and there is a very bad condition on the, of course, there nothing grows up over there. There is a lot of salt on the soil, and people don't have water for consuming. So La Pampa made a claim against Mendoza, and the national court had to decide about it. The national court, or the Supreme Court, did not want to declare the river as a person, but almost did it. So perhaps we'll see that in the future it will come something like that. In the judgment, it came out on December of 2017, it says that rivers are not part of property as it used to be, but nowadays, according to human rights treatises and the now or the new civil and commercial code, we have a new paradigm, and we cannot conceive rivers as property, and we cannot see or define rivers from an anthropocentrical conception, but from a systemic and ecocentrical conception. The same arguments that Colombia used. But in this case, the court said, okay, you have to make an arrangement between the two provinces, you have to create new institution that should regulate how you are going to distribute the water of the river. The main question is, if the two provinces don't make an agreement, the river will be just the way it is, and so I think that there will be another complaint against in the court, and in that case perhaps we'll see something more similar to what happened in Colombia. But nowadays rivers are not persons. And the last case is the one of legal persons, so institutions that are created to pursue aims and that have rights and duties according to those aims. Well, there are a lot of problems. The first question is, do legal persons have fundamental rights? Well, that's a big discussion. The Inter-American Court was asked about it by the state of Panama, but the same opinion is applied to all the other countries. The Inter-American Court said no, under no conditions legal persons have fundamental rights, except for two cases. One of them is unions, but only on what concerns, for example, to the protection of workers, but nothing else. And the other exception that's quite important is the one of indigenous communities, because there is usually communities or indigenous communities have a different relation between the community and the individual, which, by the way, is quite a big problem, because there are some cases in which individuals complain against the community because they want individual rights, but community denies them. And so there is a very big problem about identity in indigenous communities and individual rights. On legal persons, not only the idea of fundamental rights are important, but also on what comes to liability. Well, to what extent are legal persons responsible for example, criminal or crimes? Well, a few years ago, in 2006, there was a judgment of the Supreme Court that said that, we are sorry, but legal persons are not responsible for crimes. But a few years ago, in 2017, a law was passed in which legal persons are responsible for crimes that have to do with corruption. That was mainly because there was there were a lot of cases in which very big corporations were involved with scandals of corruption. But that's the only case. It was discussed on whether legal persons could be responsible for more or other kind of crimes, but so far legislator of the Congress said no. That's a very big problem nowadays. Mainly, for example, in this case of liability, the only sanction is a fine that the companies have to pay if they are found responsible. And in this case, the money of the fine will be destinated to education purposes. But if you can imagine that perhaps a very big corporation, it might be a very good deal to pay a fine, but still keep doing some lobby or some other payments to get some benefits. So it's still it's an advance, but it's still not enough. Mainly there are other cases about legal persons and their liability, but I think that that's the most interesting detail about it. So are all these the cases that challenge the legal concept of person? Well, of course not. I think that there are a lot of other challenges. Perhaps these are the ones that have been showing up in Argentina's legal system. As you can see, we have no certainty about what a person is. At some point, we know that the human person that has already been born is a person. but discussions remain on the rest, and the consequences about them, it's a very, very big deal. Having all these problems about definitions and this uncertainty, I think that has or brings up a new problem that, as I said at the beginning, the idea that we have of a person defines a lot on what can we do against the state, against the right, and what can we do with a law to protect us. So when there is no certainty about it, a lot of problems come up.